Hello, everybody, and welcome to AfricaWorks E-Squared, the podcast about education, employability, employment, and entrepreneurship in Africa. My name is Jörg, and with me today is my colleague Raoul.
Hey, everybody. Thanks for listening, and great to be here.
Raoul, today will be about how to deliver a convincing CV. And I guess what we have already said, and we will keep saying this to you, this is all based on our personal experience as recruiters and as coaches. And before we start, let me tell you what we will not be talking about and what we won't be covering today. And that is how to structure your CV or resume and what parts it consists of. So we won't do the first comes your name and your ad. And there are in fact some regional differences which you may even be better aware of. Instead, what we will tell you today is what I'd say 99% of all CVs that we have evaluated over the last years share and have in common that don't make it into the second round, that are not considered by HR managers. Kind of like a best of what you should avoid or best of what you should not do. So we went ahead and structured our episode for you, and in fact we want you to take away a few important lessons from this episode that you are encouraged to try out or adopt next time you go over your CV. So Raoul, which are our lessons and golden rules for today?
Well, we are going to share with you our three golden rules of CV design, and they are called, first, be tidy, don't be sloppy. Mm-hmm. Second, be you, but stick to the essentials. And third, keep adapting, keep enhancing.
Now, when looking at those golden rules, they all have in common that in one way or another, some more than others, they will deal with the three basics of, you know, form, content, and language. So what you already know from school, what we all know already from school, when your essay was probably evaluated based on grammar, spelling, diction, storytelling, and so on. The same applies here, and it is all enshrined in our golden rules. So that was just one preliminary remark. And one last reminder, as you may remember from our episode number 2, which was called Job Search 101, HR managers, recruiters, and CEOs, they all have different standards when it comes to screening your CVs. However, as a principle, as I explained to you in that episode, that when your profile matches over 60% of what is required in the job description, roughly, then you can give it a shot. So let's start with our golden rules, Raoul, and let us turn to our first one, which was again, be tidy and don't be sloppy. Obviously, first of all, that means no typos. And you don't mind me saying this, I know this can sometimes cause big injustice, great unfairness, especially if you are in fact much more qualified than somebody else who does not deliver a CV with typos in it. And we wish it were different. Sometimes recruiters place too much emphasis on the importance of typos or the lack of the same. And I personally believe we should get away from that, because it's more about measuring all the relevant factors for assessing a candidate's fit. And in 99%, that is more than just grammar. If you're applying for a role as executive assistant, your language skills may be more important than when you go into, let's say, mechanical engineering. So that should be accounted for. Anyway, typos is a big issue, right?
You're right, Jörg, definitely. But that's just the way it is, you know. Some people in the HR will tell you, oh boy, when I find the first typo, they are out, you know. It can be that hard. So we keep telling you, use your autocorrect. You can install Grammarly or one of those funky add-ons to your browser. You can have somebody else to proofread, for example, you know. Mm-hmm. So just make sure you don't diminish your chances by something so trivial as a typo.
Okay, so typos are just one smaller issue of being tidy. More importantly, let's talk about form.
Okay, now we're turning to the crucial issues. Okay, so format is what makes or breaks your CV.
What do you mean by form, or as others refer to it, format?
Format basically covers everything revolving around the issue of how your CV is arranged and what it looks like. So it's about two things, I would say, structure and design. Structure is about what comes when, like an outline. We all know the different sections like personal data, professional experience, education, etc., etc., you name it. But structure also covers how we use the space in those sections.
So, like what comes during the part of your professional experience, when you enlist, what you did, where, until when?
Exactly. The principle is you can choose your format, but please be concise. Stick to it. If you have chosen one, you should stay with it. So use the same format for the rest of the resume. Don't switch back and forth. You know what I mean? I had a great phone interview with a candidate who contacted me on LinkedIn, and I asked him to send me a CV so I could forward it to the client, and what I received at the end was a mix of three font sizes, bold and underlined words. That's simply too much, you know? So I called him back and told him, listen, I think we are going to have to go back to the drawing board on your CV here.
There's something here that just came to my mind, and that is the usage of the tab button, you know, on your keyboard.
Sure, yes, definitely.
You know how on your keyboard you use the long space bar at the bottom for spaces in between words and letters. And then there is the tab button, and I find that many, especially graduates that we worked with, who sign up with us, they simply neglect the tab button. And that's the far left button with both arrows pointing to the left and right on your keyboard. Let me tell you, people, that tab button should become your best friend in any application. If you want the spaces between your words and, you know, vertical parts on your document to be and remain in the same distance from one another, please don't use the space bar. Don't be someone who starts pressing the space bar for nearly 1,000 times and who hopes that the outline will be concise. It will never be. That's just the way that Word works, and because that's what the tab button has been created for. Of course, you can adapt the length of the jumps you do with the tab bar, but in any case, please use it. Consider it your best friend. We've had so many CVs where people don't use it and it just looks sloppy.
Yes, and unfortunately, the personal conclusion is here for everyone, German, European, wherever you're from. If the CV looks sloppy, the person is a sloppy worker who doesn't deliver clean and directly usable work. And therefore, we are not going to hire the candidates. That is the impression the employer or the HR person gets in the first hand.
True. Raoul, while we're at it, we are asked very often, especially when it comes to the professional experience and the education sector, what people should put in it and where. What's your answer?
Basically the same as what I said before. Be concise. Be concise. To me, it doesn't matter really if you put the years on the left-hand side or on the right-hand side.
As long as you use the tab button.
Exactly. As long as you use the tab button. And as long as you keep the same space between lines as well. You know, some of the CVs also contain a multitude of different lines, spacing, and that's just awful to look at. But coming back to your question, actually, for example, in your professional experience section, clearly describe your position and your responsibilities and always use the same format. That's actually what we just said in the beginning. But an example, company name, maybe the industry, the location of where that job was, if you worked in different countries or cities, etc., and then the position or title, and then bullet points of, you know, the key task achievements, you know. Yeah, this is absolutely crucial, but that's already it in terms of what to put where, you know?
I guess the best formatting in that regard is the one that makes it easy for the hiring manager to skim over the resume and still recognize your key qualifications and career goals. So again, clean paragraphs, same font, but nothing squiggly, and that already starts with Times New Roman, I would say. Really, if you're not sure, use Arial, I would suggest, and give it a darker grayish color, but don't use something unprofessional like Comic Sans or anything like that.
I would even refrain from using Calibri because it's been pre-formatted to be used and most computers that operate with Microsoft Word. Then the same with font size. Maybe use a maximum of two different sizes, like 11, maybe 12, and 13 for headings. You know, that's enough. If you do use different colors, what you just said, don't use more than two either.
Mm-hmm. That brings us to design. Remember, structure was the first big issue here when it comes to being tidy. Mm-hmm. Design is the second. So what is important when it comes to design, Raoul?
I would say design is not everything, but it may elevate your CV from being a convincing one to a great one, an eye catcher. You know, I want to hire that person thing, you know? Design depends on the company you're applying for and the role you're looking at. Try to put yourself in the hiring manager's shoes. If we were talking about a traditional employer, what helps as a starting point in terms of design is also to mirror your CV with their website. You can also cross-check what language the company uses, for example. Some companies are cool, hip, others are more conservative. And then there are many that don't really invest a whole lot into self-marketing. So, yeah, I would say aligning here, that can really help.
Raoul, what about language? Is language important when it comes to being tidy in your CV?
I would say not as much as the format issue, where we see the most disturbing things happen. You know? But be clean here as well. You are not a engineer, you are an engineer. And you are not business developer, you are a business developer. And your CV should not contain the words me or she or mine, etc. Many the third person perspective. I would even avoid that. I mean, it's obvious that it's you who did these things that are written in the CV. Yeah? So I always suggest to use the telegraphic style, like design of open source software or scaling up a platform to over 10,000 users. Or B2B sales to 15 businesses in 6 African markets in West Africa, for example. So don't use full sentences. If you spell everything out, it has the same effect as long paragraphs. You just fly over them. And another thing, do avoid punctuation errors like I have done that, full stop, comma, now I do this. We have really seen a lot.
Thank you for sharing that here as well, Raoul. Now, to all our listeners, we are going to be doing a quick FAQ / Q&A at the end, so we will share more concrete pieces of advice, especially on format, content, and language. But now, and this is just for your information, let us turn to the second golden rule, because I think we have covered many of the be tidy, don't be sloppy issues. So the second golden rule is be you, but please stick to the essentials, or be an essentialist. And this goes back to our very first podcast episode, people. You remember, not all things are equally important. In fact, if all things are equally important, they automatically become equally unimportant, which means that nothing stands out. So, first piece of advice,
avoid too many bullet points.
Exactly. But summary at the top of people's CV. We see that a lot, the introductory section of your CV, so to speak. And while in Europe this is rather the exception than the rule, in many African countries, and we've seen this in Nigeria, Kenya, South Africa, but also up to Morocco, personal summaries are common. And even in the US, they are. Personal summaries like, I'm a skilled communicator, I'm a content creator, skilled in XYZ, able to XYZ, with a driving passion for XYZ, or when it comes to essentials. And now, clinging to our golden rule, sticking to what really matters, what is your advice?
Yes, I have found over the years that many summaries contain many adjectives. Now, the risk you run at this is why we keep telling you that less is more, that less is more, is that hiring manager easily loses track of what exactly the applicant is good for now. So in general, I would say you should avoid long summaries. Also, try to avoid spongy expressions.
What do you mean?
You know, there are candidates who will put in functioned as a team player, creating synergies with exceptional communication skills to deliver concrete solutions and proactively implementing core competencies.
So, I know what you mean, yeah.
So this is all well intended, but it's spongy, you know. It's not concrete and full of generalization that don't set you apart. Everybody will keep wondering what exactly those exceptional communication skills are and how exactly the candidate delivered concrete solutions and what proactively means. And if I may add this, Jörg, you should all follow the rule that competencies need to be proven through facts. And that's what the bullet points are for as well. So show what you achieved. Everybody can claim to be great team player, communicator, reliable specialist, and so on. That's what the bullet points are for. Show what you have achieved. This will help you tremendously in proving why you should be given the chance to do an interview. Let me also say one more thing here. There are so many CVs I have looked at in which personal summaries read something like, I'm a hard-working person with good communication skills. I am saying, sorry, that simply won't cut it. Working person with good communication skills. I am saying, sorry, that simply won't cut it. Being hard-working is a precondition by pretty much everybody, because if you weren't, you would be lazy and then nobody would hire you because you would be too expensive. And the same with good communication skills. They're not a competency as such, but much rather a condition. In other words, companies will expect you to dispose of these skills no matter what.
Actually, we're going to deal with that specific issue in our next episode, where we will talk about cover letters.
Right.
Raoul, let's go one step further. I suppose that what you mentioned about sticking to the essentials also applies to the professional experience section in the CV as well, correct?
I would say everybody should decide how many bullet points they want to use for each job before turning to the next one. Because not all activities and achievements are equally important for the position you're applying for. The same applies to the jobs. Not all the jobs you did or had are equally important for the position you're applying for. Yes, I would say everybody should decide how many bullet points they want to use for each job before turning to the next one. Because not all activities and achievements are equally important for the position you're applying for. The same applies to the jobs. Not all jobs you did or had are equally important for the position you're applying for. You get where I'm going with this?
Of course. What does this being an essentialist mean for diction or the choice of words? when it comes to language?
First of all, you are not responsible for updates, responsible for taking care of, responsible for tweeting, responsible for this, responsible for that. Instead, you need to tell your story. And in that story, you need to decide what matters for the role at hand. If you just enlist what you were responsible for, that might be even seen as a sign of laziness. So please explain exactly what you have done instead of just enumerating the requirements of the job.
And what is more, if I may add, many applicants often want to make it as clear as possible that they really meet the requirements of the job description. So they tend to list abilities, for example, as follows. I can prove ability X, ability Y, and ability Z as my time in company XYZ shows. However, your goal should not be to show that you are qualified for the job, but that you are more qualified than any other applicant. So again, ask yourself, what sets you apart from the others? Why should you be taken?
Oh, and I have another thing. When it comes to the listing of your achievements, don't say just you have reached A, B, or C. You can even do better than that by putting facts into it. Say, for example, instead of increased sales, rather project X has led to an increase in sales by Y percent.
Now, Raoul, all this is super important for people who have job experience, who actually have something to put in their CV. Mm-hmm. But when we look at our audience, many of the ones who are also students and young graduates, they may feel like, oh, there is really not a whole lot to put in for me. How should they do it? What's your advice to them?
Yes, thanks for that question, because we get that question a lot in our workshops. First of all, you are who you are. And it would be very strange if you already had 10 years of work experience as a business development manager as a 25-year-old graduate. Now, what is my advice? First of all, avoid blowing or puffing up your CV. You know, even though it may not be as long, the principle of being essentialist also applies to you here again.
Especially applies to you people. And if I may say so, do listen to episode 1 again if you're not sure where to start on what to put in.
Right. Generally, candidates with less or hardly any relevant work experience also need to end up being one page only, be concise and start putting in the things that you have done, especially if they are relevant to the job at hand, based on what you found out to be your true strength and skills. Everybody will find that at one point there's a connection between that company they are looking at, that role they wish to be hired for, and that specific program they feel they should join, etc. You know, the downside to that is that it takes much longer. You will have to put an extra effort into composing your CV, much more than someone with work experience. But you should definitely invest that extra time and brain power, because it will pay off.
So in consequence, even if I've never done something in my life, I would be able to come up with something to present.
Yes and no. I mean, if you have never done anything in your life except to go to school and to university, which quite frankly leaves people in Kenya, Nigeria, Ghana or elsewhere I interview have done, then you obviously cannot just put something in your CV under professional experience. Mm-hmm. But, and here it starts with the storytelling part again, many have done something along the way that somehow directly relates to the company or jobs they find interesting. And then, yes, one should put it in. It needs to be phrased and framed right.
Raoul, that brings me to another important question, one that we are also frequently confronted with during our coaching sessions and workshops. And it goes, I'm sorry, but I'm not sure, or I don't know whether I should put in my CV that I did this and that, or if I'm this and that. whether to include it or not. Do you have something to share here that can give them better guidance?
Yes. I know exactly of the challenge that this entails.
You have had that problem with your own CV, huh?
you name it, yes. So what we basically teach in our coaching sessions is not one-size-fits-all solution, but it may serve as a guideline, you can say. And it works like a CV content filter. When you are confronted with the question whether you should mention something in your CV, there are basically four questions you should ask yourself. First, is it a CV issue? Second, is it related to a certain job, role, or industry? And third, is it relevant to the job at hand? Those are the three main questions you should be able to answer with a yes. And then you put it in.
And what's the fourth question?
That is in fact more of a corrective, so a question you apply in order to correct your result. And that is, does it define you?
Wait, I think you should elaborate more on this in detail. Let's go back to number one.
Yes. The first question you should answer for yourself is it actually a CV-related issue? So in other words, is it a job experience? Is it about school or university education? Is it a skill? Is it a competency? And so on.
So you think that this is already important? This is still very basic.
I know, it's basic, but it's important to do this step by step. It's also important because we keep receiving CVs where graduate mentioned that they like to do outdoor hiking. To do this step by step. It's also important because we keep receiving CVs where graduate mentioned that they like to do outdoor hiking or other lists of hobbies. And then, unless you are applying for a job as a tour guide, or you know your boss likes hiking or whatever hobby, you should not put that in. It's nice, but it's not essential. And what is not essential is what we generally leave out. There are exceptions to that.
And I'm sure we will come to those exceptions. Let me give you a test question here, Raoul. Let's pretend I speak Mandarin at a basic level. Should I put that in? I don't speak it fluently. I just started. So beginner's level. Should I put that in?
Well, it's definitely a skill, a language skill. So the first question would be answered in the affirmative.
What about the second question?
The second ones who helped her parents out in their family business. Turns out that the family business was a chain of bakeries all over Lagos. Her activity was general support, you know, carrying things, packing, sometimes acting as a cashier and so forth. She only mentioned that in the interview and I didn't understand why. Well, that has to do with a job, a role, and certainly an industry. So yes, put that in for now. On the other hand, we keep receiving CVs where people put in the elementary school they went to.
Okay, I can see where you're going with this. So we are slowly narrowing down what we put in by going through those questions.
Yeah, I mean, though, those first two questions are really a no-brainer and they are typically reflected in every CV outline already. But still, they are really a no-brainer and they are typically reflected in every CV outline already. But still, every now and then we receive irrelevant data and then can be avoided.
So the third question.
This is a crucial one. It is according to your interpretation of the job at hand. Is what you want to put in, is it relevant to the job at hand?
Okay, relevant to the job at hand.
This, of course, cannot be generally answered because it can only be answered on a case-by-case analysis. So coming back to your Mandarin example, if Mandarin is required, then yes, put it in. Your chances of getting the job are low if you are supposed to be fluent in Mandarin. But it's relevant to the job at hand. If Mandarin is not required, you can leave it. However, I have to admit you might want to keep it in. For example, the company is from China or mm-hmm. intending to expand from China or into China or Asian market. You may also keep it in if it's relevant to the job at hand to be a fast learner, because learning a language in certain amount of time can show you are a fast learner. So it allows a conclusion about your character and your skills. Let me give you another example. We talked about hobbies. Nobody cares if you enjoy playing computer games, of course, only if you work in or apply in that field. Now, the same applies to work experience. For a job in the IT industry, it does not matter if you spend your holidays cooking and cleaning.
What about short-term jobs that I had as a candidate?
I would say the same here. Stick to what matters. It's important to leave the jobs out of the CV that you have only been in for a very short time, especially jobs that you did not like or you were fired at. But here again, if it's a job you made maybe for, I don't know, 6 months, and it really was an eye-opening job, or it was relevant to the job at hand, then it maybe makes sense to put it in.
And if I may add, if this is the only experience you have as a young graduate, then it's okay to leave the short ones in. Maybe you even have several shorter ones accumulated over a certain period of time. So several three-month internships, then that's also okay. But if you already have 10 years of work experience, then no, hit delete and enter. Coming back to step number four, Raoul. Now, what was that all about?
That's the overall corrective. Sometimes there are things you still want to put in because they define you so strongly and it contributes to the overall picture you are presenting about yourself. Then you should also put them in if that conveys something about your personality and if there are something like a conclusion that the recruiter can draw from that. Maybe a specific achievement that also meant something to you personally. Then it's okay to still put that in.
Can you give an example? I mean, we already talked about the Mandarin example where the recruiter is able to derive mm-hmm. that you are a fast learner because you only did this 2-month course and you're already able to speak a little. Do you have another maybe?
As I said, this is an overall corrective. I would say this is more about you and the message you want to deliver, what kind of person you are. Sometimes candidates worked in, for example, socially relevant field, like a hospital or an orphanage. So if this is truly important to you, then of course, by all means, put it then in. Huh? If you feel that's important to you, it means that you are willing to assume responsibility. So in other words, don't neglect your past or ignore your biography or pretend you are a person you are not by leaving things out that are important to you.
So coming back to the example of learning Mandarin, I know I'm using that quite a lot. Maybe you are not fluent, but maybe you went to China and lived abroad for half a year. It has been an important part of your life, and it shows that you can be independent, even though it may not even have anything to do with the job at hand, with the industry, with the role that you are looking at. So try to reflect and see the overall picture. Again, it shows that you can be an independent person, and that is a skill that is required in certain jobs nowadays. So again, it's about the general picture, an overall consideration of your individual case.
Exactly.
Raoul, let's turn to our third golden rule. And this is going to be a quick one. Keep adapting, keep enhancing. Adapt your CV to each role, and we keep saying this again and again.
Absolutely. We are aware that this means a lot of extra work. In principle, you don't have to rewrite everything again and again, But usually that's correct.
So what's your advice? What should I, as an applicant, take into consideration here?
I would say know your target audience. Your application does not have to please your friends, but the person who will hold it in their hand and decide if you will get the job or not. HR managers do not see it as their job to seek the interesting point from the load of information you provide them with. This is actually your job to make it concrete as well. One trick can even be not to look at it from your own perspective only. Sure, it's about your achievements, your background, your experiences, etc., but it's not about you. It's a professional advertisement geared towards your potential boss. Perhaps you're proud of some of the experience that are of great value. Perhaps you're proud of some of the experience that are of great value to you, but completely irrelevant to your future boss.
This is also relevant for the third step of our filter of what you put in and what you leave out your CV, correct?
Correct, exactly. Your entire application is an advertisement, actually. It does not have to please you 100%, but your future boss. When applying, you are the product and the boss is the customer. This sounds a little edgy. Of course, you are not just a product. Huh? It's obvious. But it's kind of a trick that might help you. Now, one last thing. Simple, don't lie. Whatever you put in your CV that is not true, it means you will just be sitting on a ticking time bomb.
I'm very glad that you mentioned this, because this is an issue that we're asked about every now and then. How much am I allowed to stretch the truth? And last, keeping up with adapting your CV means keeping up with enhancing it.
Definitely. You're right. I mean, what we mean by that is to consider your CV to be a work in process all the time. This means, for example, ask for feedback and get true feedback and reflect on what you're sending out. Huh? This is not a once in a lifetime thing, but something that needs to grow organically. It helps just to sit down in front of it every 4 or 6 months, for example, even when you are still in university, and think about what has been important to you. What gave you meaning, specific activities you did that could become relevant, more like a journal, and then you can filter that out when you get on the job market.
For those of you who have already received their degrees, try to reflect, and this is my two cents here, what things you did years ago that you may have forgotten, but still may constitute skills that you might want to put back in, of course, in accordance with the rules that we explained earlier.
Your CV is never really finished. 5 years from now, you're going to look differently on it, and that's for sure, I can guarantee you that.
Raoul, thanks so much for discussing our three golden rules. Again, people, first, be tidy, don't be sloppy, very important. Second, be you, but stick to the essentials. And third, keep adapting and keep essentials. And third, keep adapting and keep enhancing. Now, last but not least, I prepared a final Q&A round. So, Raoul, a small set of frequently asked questions, so to speak, that keep popping up in our coachings and workshops. Things that can be answered rather swiftly. Are you ready?
I am ready.
Okay, let's go for it. Raoul, how long should a CV be altogether?
Yes, that cannot be so easily stated.
This was supposed to be a quick Q&A.
I did try my best. I would say one pages in general becoming more the rule than the exception, I would say. That's my feeling. I've seen many with nice designs, even in a horizontal format. In general, I would say whatever is longer than 3 pages goes against our golden rule, which was number two, about sticking to the essentials. I guess someone with relevant work experience can use 2 pages, but that's all I would generally say here, but it really depends on the individual case, of course.
Thank you. Next question, Raoul. Headshot or no headshot? Photo or no photo?
I think it's very uncommon to use photos in Africa, my experience. In Europe, it's more common, but even there, it is decreasing. In any case, if you are applying with a photo, it must be a professional one. And then again, you can check the company and see whether your style mirrors theirs. Yes.
Okay, that's pretty clear. Salary expectations or no salary expectations. Should we put that in a CV or not?
No salary expectations. No salary expectations. I have seen a few South African applicants put that in, for example, but this information is unnecessary at this stage. It sends out a false message to the HR manager. Your CV is supposed to highlight your professional experience and your skills. So the salary is dealt with a later stage in the application process.
What about high school grades?
No, nobody cares about that.
Okay, pretty clear. University grades.
If you are fresh from the university and have grade degrees, it's okay to leave it on your resume. But if the degree is from more than, let's say, 3 years ago, or not super strong, you should not mention them.
How do we deal with gaps in our curriculum? How do we deal with gaps in our CV?
Oh boy, that's a tough one. Unfortunately, larger gaps do raise concerns. And personally, I'm not a fan of turning down people simply because they have that one or that the other gap in their CV. Sometimes you cannot really avoid them, right?
True.
And sometimes your job search does take longer, for example, you know, or individual cases. One way to close those gaps is, of course, voluntary work. Maybe you can be engaged in different things, maybe social activities while you are job hunting. That will then also say something positive about your character. What helps, of course, if it has something to do with the job you want to have later. So helping out in a hospital, maybe if you want to be a physician. Another possibility is, of course, to do online courses and further educate yourself.
What are some of those online courses that you are referring to?
There are many. I can just name here Khan Academy. .org, codeacademy.com, or even wikihow.com.
True, there is so much out there in that field. Any other possibilities to close the gaps?
I know of some people who did work and travel, for example, but it depends on whether you want to fill a gap with that in your CV. If it includes volunteering, maybe.
Another possibility that I have actually seen people do is to create their own website, right? What do you think about that?
Why not? I mean, your own website can be quickly and easy created. It can be your personal kind of business card.
Mm-hmm. And last, there's always the chance to do more internships, right? I know that sometimes it gets harder and harder to get out of that cycle where you are only doing internships. But, and I'm again referring to episode number one, if you use them right and you network right, they can actually be your way out and therefore your step up the career ladder. Also, you will have something to put in your CV. Any other last piece of advice that you have and that you want to share?
Please, people, listen up. use a professional email address. So no turtle94@hotmail.com or even your nickname and some weird combination of numbers like 82745@gmail.com.
So turtle94@hotmail.com was the worst that you have ever witnessed.
I don't want to mention that one, yeah.
So people, please invest the 2 minutes to get a reputable email address. Raoul, I believe we have covered quite a lot today. Thank you for sharing your insights.
It was great pleasure.
This is it for today's episode. Feel free to share the words, spread the love, and like us on LinkedIn. I am already looking forward to our next episode, in which we will have a smooth transition to yet another delicate issue that is closely connected with today's, namely cover letters. We hope you enjoyed this episode.